What's going on? What's going on, everybody? Good to be back. Round two indeed. How you guys feeling today? Where are you guys tuning in from? Mexico, how we doing? Slovenia, how we doing? Argentina, hello. Norway, hello. More Mexico. Leicester, UK. Portsmouth, Paris. Wow, there's a lot of you here. Awesome. Well, last time was fun. I really enjoyed talking to you guys, and feel like I've got my hand on this a little bit more now, and I know what some of the buttons do, so that's good. And yeah, thanks for people who subscribed. That's really awesome, and for following. And also, let me just turn this music down for a second. If you hit the donate button, not the subscribe button, but the donate button, we've got that linked at the moment to make a charitable donation to Great Ormond Street Children's Hospital in London. It's actually somewhere I went as a kid. I had like a really bad eating problem when I was, well, zero until about three. And so I went there and they taught me how to eat, basically. So they definitely helped save my life in some way, I would say. So if you feel like dipping into your pockets, if you can, donate button will take you there. Let's see if we can raise some money for the kids and for the hospital. I'm sure it's been pretty crazy during COVID times there. So that's where we're at. One other thing I wanted to say is there was a few requests last time in the chat for the ability to do a 720 transcode. That's actually something I can't do. I can either do it at 180 or 720. So I've decided to stick to 180. And we've emailed Twitch and we've asked a lot about whether or not we can get the option open, because only partners get that and I'm not a partner. So hopefully the connection's all good for you guys. But we are working on getting the ability to make it 720 at the same time. So that's cool. Some of you have already spotted what's over my shoulder there. And you're absolutely right. That is my album. Finished on vinyl, wrapped up, looking good. Just give you a little view on the inside. Jeez. Yeah, it feels pretty crazy to be holding it finally. I'll show you the vinyl inside actually. The vinyl inside is all beautifully colored. Jeez, look at that. So yeah, you can pre-order that right now. The link is on our page. I think it takes you to, I don't know where it takes you. Merch? I guess press merch, that'll do it. This record took a lot of work and I'm very happy to be holding it. It's made entirely out of completely recycled cardboard and paper. And the vinyl itself as well is fully recycled from, well, maybe not fully, but basically as eco-friendly as an album can possibly be on vinyl. The vinyl itself is made up of recycled pellets of plastic and other stuff, so yeah, trying to make it as friendly as we can. So yeah, you can go and pre-order that now. And I'm also wearing this t-shirt, Kitchen Mix t-shirt. Let me show you the back. I think these are out now, maybe not, but if not, they're coming soon, and there's a bunch of other t-shirts on there, which you guys might want to check out. All right, enough plugging. Good news, some really good news. I don't know if some of you have already seen it, but I want to show you guys this. Let me turn off the tunes. Big announcement. Marley Marley premiering tomorrow at last. Thank you. Thank you all very much. Yeah, I know you guys have probably been waiting for that one since the Boiler Room video. So yeah, video's dropping tomorrow. You can click a link there and like it so that I think you'll be reminded. But yeah, 7:30 p.m. UK time. So that'll be out tomorrow. And yeah, I'm really happy with the video. I don't want to give too much away, but it was all shot during lockdown. So it was a socially isolated kind of, I don't know how else to describe it. It's like the best video we could have possibly tried to make during a lockdown, especially internationally, shooting Fatoumata herself. Her brother is in it dancing. There's a ton of others dancing in it. Lots of drone shots. And yeah, I'm really happy with it. It's not like any video we've done before. Well, I guess it's mostly like white noise with the dancing. But yeah, it's super colorful, super vibrant, really positive. So yeah, that is happening tomorrow. Minimize that. Can I play it? I'm afraid not, because Universal will be mad at me and they'll probably take the stream down or something. I don't know. But you can go and watch it on the Boiler Room YouTube channel. So that's there. What else are you guys saying? How's everybody's weekend been? I actually went away last week, which was nice. Oh, that was before the last stream. Yeah, I think it was. Anyway. You guys all just look really excited. Let's hear the kitchen mix. Working this weekend. Is it just me? Yeah, just me again today. I did actually see Howard yesterday though, and he's all good. We were doing a ton of interviews, lots of promo. Put the chicken back on. Yeah, we're doing a ton of promo, and we shot a mix as well. There's going to be a new mix by us. Can't say too much more at the moment in case who it's for doesn't want me to. But yeah, there'll be a mix by us somewhere on Friday. So that's something to look forward to. My opinion on the C214 mic. I don't think I have an opinion. I don't think I've used one. Is that the Sony one? Is it the black one? If it is, I don't love it, to be honest. It's very toppy, very trebly, very poppy. I prefer a more... where's it from? I've forgotten where it's from already, but... Oh, the AKG C214. It's nice. Okay, yeah. I can't say I know, to be honest. My first mic was an AKG. It was like 50 quid, and it did me the world of good. And it was all I needed at the time. But luckily now I can afford the Neumann. Cheers, everyone. Oh, yeah. I'm no expert, but that's definitely red wine. Yeah, it's not white. It's not rosé either. It's definitely red. Yeah, I'm getting hints of red, more red, and wine. That's what it's... yeah, that's what it is. So, yeah, I thought what we would do, apart from just hang out and chat... Where is your room treatment from? Oh, damn. I actually don't know. I did it myself. So the panels I bought online, just a selection, and then I put them up myself just with a drill and some screws. So they're not placed correctly. They pretty much just took the reverb away from the room. They didn't really do much in terms of like helping the sound travel in a more balanced way. It just stopped the echo. It's also a tiny room, so that helps. For me, anyway, I like a smaller room, and I like to, you know, sit where the bass is. I talked about this last time, I think. Like, I pulled my whole desk into the center of the room, like you can see here. See, I'm like way back, and I used to be like up against that wall, and now I'm like back here because the bass is here. So, to be honest, before you start treating your room, have a sit around it, put some speakers up. Yeah, have a walk around, feel out where the different frequencies are, and try and pick the most neutral spot, I guess. But for making dance music, I like to be in the bass. So, yeah, I'm in the sub here. Roland Boutique stuff. Do you have a problem with latency? Not with that stuff. No, not really. I mean, I'm running Logic. As long as you got the no latency button pressed, it seems fine. The MIDI and stuff talks perfectly. And I like it because it's just one USB cable. Talked about those a lot last time. Got the G50, SH101, and the SEO2, and the 303. I like it. Did you make the rack for the Roland Boutique units? No, you just Google Roland Boutique rack. There's a load of them. Although it was promised that it was made of ebony wood, and I was like really excited for it to be really nice. It's definitely not. It's like plywood that someone's just made in their garage. So yeah, I'm not super impressed with that, but it does the job, and it's a studio anyway, so everything gets trashed. We need an essential mix. We actually did one ages ago. Did an essential mix already. I would love to do one again, though. I feel like my knowledge of music has grown a lot since that mix. So, yeah, I think there's probably room for improvement. Wow, I can't keep up with this tonight, guys. It's good to have you all here. Another boiler room of Scream. Yeah, we did talk about that on Twitter the other day. I would like to do that. What happened with the Roland Gaia? That is still in storage, I think, from the live show. And that's kind of Howard's synth, so maybe it's at his house, in his place, his studio. He's got a small studio in his house too. It might be there, I'm not sure. Do you have one MIDI controller routed for all your synths? I do. Well, actually, no, I have two. I have this tiny one here, this little X key thing, and then that one over there, that Akai one, that controls all my Logic synths. Yeah, anything. I can just, you know, arm it on Logic and off you go. Top five plugins. Oh, difficult. I mean, we talked about Soothe last time. Soothe is an amazing plugin for high frequency ducking. If you want to make something a little less harsh, like guitars or vocals or a whole mix, that's brilliant. The Pro-Q 3 by FabFilter, I would say, is like absolutely dope. I use that a lot. Stop the music now. Yeah, Pro-Q 3 with the dynamic EQ, that's epic. Sound Toys Decapitator, use that a lot. These are just plugins that are not already in Logic, to be honest. So yeah, a lot of my favorite plugins are just in Logic already. But Battery, I'm like couldn't make drums without Battery. Well, I used to use Ultra Beat, but yeah, Battery for me. And if I had to pick one more, the Oxford Inflator is amazing. It's on Universal Audio, but I think you can get it on Waves or maybe just through Oxford themselves. The Oxford Inflator is banging. Yeah, that's a good five. That's a good five. I can't believe I didn't include a compressor in that, but my favorite compressors are kind of outboard anyway, I guess. Do you plan on making your own record label? We actually do have one with our managers called Method Records and Method White. Hasn't been like... We haven't been super active with it over the last couple of years, but yeah, we did release a lot. Back in the day, 5 years ago, we did an MJ Cole release. We did a Friend Within release. We did Eats Everything. You guys know that song? Let's go dancing. I want to go dancing with you all night dancing. Yeah, that was, I think that was us. All right, let's get back. Do you play instruments? I do. I play the drums mostly. I played drums since I was, my mum says like literally one, because I was smashing pots and pans in the kitchen since that age. So I guess that counts as one. But yeah, I've been playing drums on stage at school my whole life. You know, I don't remember a time not, I don't remember learning the drums, which is very strange. It's like, I know I obviously did, but it was as if I was born knowing how to like play a beat, because I don't remember learning it at all. But guitar, I remember learning. My dad plays guitar, so I did a lot of that when I was younger. I used to be into kind of like fingerstyle, Andy McKee, Antoine Dufour, Don Ross, like that stuff, you know, the really tappy. Newton Faulkner as well, he's a good dude. Yeah, I used to be really into that kind of fingerstyle playing, because it was kind of half drumming and half guitar, so I tried to get good at that, but I just couldn't do it. I wasn't as good as those guys by a long way. Plus, I mean Andy McKee, The Art of Motion, if you guys want to listen to an album, that is an insane acoustic guitar album. Art of Motion by Andy McKee. Pew. 10 out of 10. What do you guys think of the new Logic update? Step sequencer and new drum machine. So I really like the update, but I haven't used those elements of it too much. I did use the step sequencer a bit when I got it. But I mean, I've got a step sequencer on three bits of gear in here and another one out there. So I'm not really short on step sequencers. And, you know, the beauty of Logic for me is being able to break out of the step sequencer thing a bit and be really intricate with, you know, where you place the MIDI. And I know you can do that on the step sequencer, but it just seems like a lot of relearning. The loop mode thing seems cool. They're trying to obviously just take Ableton on. It looks good. Yeah, I just love Logic. I love the colors. I love the layout. It's a nice thing to stare at for hours. I think people forget that, you know, it's your office. You are staring at the screen for a long, long time. So, you know, you want it to be a nice place. And yeah, I said it last time, Ableton's a little bit too Windows 95 for me. They need a little update. The Drawma S73, great, great plugin. I have that on my mix out a lot. Just taking off a dB or two, beautiful multiband compressor. And I love it because it's just that one knob. I love simple plugins where you make a move and it does something immediately. You know, you don't have to think too much about what's going on. It's just, you can hear what it's doing straight away, and it usually sounds better. Favorite soft synth? Whoa, very difficult. For the latest album, for Energy, we've definitely been championing, and since Ultimatum and those EPs, really, yeah, the Poly 6, Korg Poly 6, the whole Korg Legacy edition, to be honest. I love all of those. They recently updated that as well, and it's nice. Still sounds the same, a bit better maybe, but the layout's good. Yeah, I like that. The whole of, pretty much all of Settle was made with the Logic ESP, which is an extremely basic, simplified Juno, kind of. So yeah, since owning a Juno and like getting the TAL Juno plugin, I haven't really gone back to it too much, but yeah, shout out to the Logic ESP because that thing looks basic, but it definitely kickstarted my career in a big way. So yeah, I'll pick those two. I also love Keyscape. I think Keyscape has been an absolute game changer. Like, it's so good. I know it's expensive, but if you can afford that, that is an incredible bit of software. But yeah, I need to get more into the update, to be honest. I haven't really delved too deeply into the changes. Have you ever argued with Howard? Like, seriously? Definitely not seriously, no. Jokingly. And we definitely have debates about the, you know, what's best for the music and the song. But I wouldn't call it an argument. We're not Oasis, I'm afraid. Although we have decided that in interviews we are going to start just creating fake beefs and pretending like we hate each other a little bit more. Because people ask us that all the time, that have done for like 10 years. And I think we're getting to the point now where we're just going to be like, yeah, that guy's a prick. Too much time spent with that guy. Don't like him anymore or something like that. But I think we'll make some actual fake stories, which will be, that'll be a lot of fun. Favorite books. Thanks for the subscription. Thanks to everyone for subscribing. My favorite books. I read a really good book last year, Shoe Dog, the guy who made Nike, however you guys say it. That was awesome. I think he was a really good writer, actually. You know, I think sometimes with stories and storytelling, especially if you're a businessman, you're very good at one thing, but he's also an amazing writer. Like that, I don't know how many editors there were, but yeah, that's a really good read and funny. Big George Orwell fan. 1984, Animal Farm. I mean, 1984 is like becoming real. So you don't even need to read the book. Just look at the news. Does Howard not do any production then? He does, but he mostly does playing. He plays instruments. He thinks of melodies. He thinks of chords. He sings on a lot of the tracks. He plays bass. So he's much more about the initial spark and the idea. And I'm the one doing all the tweaking and all that kind of thing. Do you start tracks with a fully realized idea in mind or just go with the flow? Go with the flow, I think. But I don't know. The initial idea is go with the flow, but I can usually get a fully formed idea for the song ready in my head within 10 or 15 minutes if the idea is good. And that's a good barometer, to be honest, because if I don't get the idea pretty quickly and I don't have an idea for the structure, I usually won't pursue it beyond that because I already know it's not going to be the one. So yeah, I know people who, I'd sometimes wake up with an idea in my head and then have to get it out. But that's usually just myself. If I'm working with Howard or anyone, I like to let them take the lead and then critique what they do constructively. Yeah. Are you going to use the Serato sampler today? Yeah, I think so. Says my chat is paused. There we go. Yeah, I will use Serato sampler. I've got the thing working, whatever you call it, serial number. Yeah, I changed laptops recently for anyone who wasn't watching last time. There was a few dead plugins, but we're back. Did you use Logic for the Control EP? We've used Logic for every Disclosure song ever made. Some alongside Ableton with Ableton Rewire, but yeah, Logic all the way, to be honest. Do you usually make your own kick drums? Yeah, every time. It's usually a layer of two or three. I mean, I'll show you guys at some point tonight. And I think last time I showed you that, the plugin, what's it called? Big Kick. I've been using Big Kick a lot for the body and like the punch and sub of the kick. And then I'll layer two or three samples over the top for like a fizz or a crackle or a attack type sound. So yeah. How was it working with Mac? I'm guessing you mean Mac Miller. Amazing day, man. Amazing day. I'll definitely do a breakdown of Blue World at some point for you guys. I'll probably just message his team first to check that that's cool from the label side of things. But yeah, an amazing day. I think I'll save the stories for that day. What do you think of Eric Prydz, Medusa, Calvin Harris, and Love Regenerator? I really like Calvin Harris. I really like his solo stuff as well. His older stuff. I mean, Acceptable in the 80s, I Get All the Girls, all those tunes. Bangers. His Love Regenerator stuff's been banging. Really, really impressed. Yeah, I'm just happy. I can tell that he's making music that he's enjoying to make. And that comes through in the music. And I really like that, you know. He's probably just sitting out in LA thinking, I've fucking nailed life. I'm just going to make techno now. And grow vegetables. Great. But yeah, the music's sick. Eric and Medusa, I don't really have as much of an opinion. But I mean, Eric Prydz's show, oh my God, is unbelievable. Calvin is boss. Yeah, he is. His newest song with Lacey is fire. Yeah, it's good. I love his vocal sound on that. The vocal's dope. How do you pick samples? Well, we don't use many samples. Well, we have been recently, but yeah, for the first two albums and everything before that, barely any sampling, to be honest. It's only something we've been doing for the last 3-4 years. So yeah, if we're sampling something like doing an edit, a disco edit, it'll usually just be of a song that I love, like that I've found through digging around on the internet. I don't really know. But for samples like drum samples, I'm a big fan of my 808 here and just recording stuff in. I do a lot of recording on the mic too, claps, finger clicks, you know. But yeah, I use a lot of stuff from Splice over the last like 3 years. And before that, it was pretty much just stock battery, stock Logic stuff, guys. Nothing too purist, to be honest. Breakdown of Talk, yeah, I'll do that one day. I will do a breakdown of every single song I've ever made, but one a day. Oh yeah, I didn't even tell you guys what we're doing today. I mean, it's in the title, but yeah, I thought because Marley Marley's coming out this week, maybe we should do a little like Fatoumata style type week. So today's Tuesday, I figured we'd do Ultimatum, the first song that we made with her. And then on Thursday, because Marley Marley's out tomorrow, Thursday we'll go through Marley Marley. So a whole week of Disclosure and Fatoumata tunes, if that's cool with you guys. Jacob Collier and Disclosure. I have actually met Jacob and we did do a day together and it was unbelievable. That guy is on a different level of insanely good. I mean, yeah. He was playing bass, he was playing grand piano, he was playing synth, he was singing. Oh, it was crazy. It was just so fun watching him run around the room and play everything as best as you possibly could play something. But all of them at the same time. That, yeah, I love him. I love his YouTube videos too. So creative with the tech side of things. Yeah, ridiculous. Hey guy, any beginner creative tips on how to just get started on a new beat? I find myself getting too caught up in the nitty gritty, like finding the perfect preset one shot instead of just going with the flow. Well, you've already diagnosed the problem, which is, you know, don't do that. Don't get too hung up on the preset. Don't get hung up on the one shot. You know, if you need a clap, just throw a clap in and change it after. If you need a bass, just pull up a bass and change it after. You know, you're never, unless you're recording through hardware or to tape, you're never committing to stuff straight away. So, you know, just get the vibe going. I used to be the same, to be honest, though. I used to spend 30, 40 minutes on a hi-hat, and now I just throw stuff at the wall. And a lot of the time, the mistakes and the imperfections are what make it really vibey. So I wouldn't get hung up on that. I would try and get as much down as you can in the first 10, 15 minutes. If you're making hip-hop, trap, house, techno, whatever, electronic stuff, you know, I can't speak for recording acoustic guitar, singer-songwriter stuff. But yeah, for getting a vibe going, as Kenny would say, don't overthink it. God, I'm going to steal his catchphrases. Do you remember what Mike Mack used to record Blue World? I think it was the M49, the Neumann M49 at Capitol Records. Capitol Studios have got some amazing microphones. They've actually got Frank Sinatra's Neumann, and it's in a box that says Frank on the box. Goosebumps. I'll try and request that mic every time we work there, because, you know, it makes the singer feel hyped, and I feel hyped just holding it and setting it up as well. So yeah, that was a if you ever get the chance to see, go to Capitol Studios, Capitol Records in LA, ask to go and see their mics, and ask to go in the archive room. The archive room downstairs is a vibe. They've got all their old tapes in there, the reel-to-reels of the original recordings of Pet Sounds. They've even got Abbey Road by the Beatles. They've even got, like, Richard Nixon's resignation speech and stuff like that, like really important moments in history in the vaults of Capitol. So, yeah, I've spent a lot of time there making beats for this album, and if I was ever feeling uninspired, I would go down to the vaults and have a look through some old tapes and see if I can get some inspiration. How did you get the Dilla expansion for Battery? It's just me taking stuff from Dilla's tunes, like, over the years. And a few packs here and there, maybe, but I honestly couldn't tell you. I really couldn't. But they are legit sounds from Dilla songs. They're not remakes or anything like that. So I've just got all of his tunes, pretty much. So if there's ever a moment in those songs where there's a or a pfft, I'll just take it. Never had much experience with mics. Are there really any differences noticeable from microphone to microphone? Huge differences. Just general quality. The amount of frequencies captured. And it's important to remember, you know, different mic for different instruments. This mic I'm using now, you know, it's a very good all-encompassing, big, wide frequency spectrum range. You know, it captures a lot. Whereas, you know, a handheld stage mic rolls off a lot of the bass because, you know, the singer doesn't need all that bass going through the mic. Yeah, I won't say too much, but there's a song on my album featuring Khalees, track one. And for the chorus of that, it's a really, like, talk boxy, distorted sounding thing. And so to get that sound, we recorded her through, like, a 1940s harmonica mic. It's this weird looking green thing. It looks like something out of the war that you'd have in a Spitfire or something. And yeah, it was quite hilarious recording arguably one of, like, the dopest ever performers and one someone we've been wanting to work with since day one, and being like, here you go, sing through this shit mic. Yeah, the rest of the song is recorded normally, but yeah, there's a moment that just it called for a crackly, crappy sounding thing. So I can't remember what it was called now, but it's a pretty much industry standard go-to harmonica mic. I'm sure one of you can figure it out. Yeah. How do you go about making a bass in Monarch? I mean, I just treat it like I would a Moog. Twist the knobs till it sounds right. Sawtooth wave would be my preference. Yeah, no sustain, quick decay, fast attack. If you want that kind of thing, mess with the cutoff and the resonance as you play. That's all I really do with it. Are you using any 500 series units? Oh, yeah. I haven't really shown you guys that yet. I don't know if you can see from up there. Maybe if I do, yeah, you can kind of see it. So yeah, here is some 500 series stuff. Let me just grab the screen and I'll move it for you a bit. There you go, that's a little bit better. So, yeah, on the left here, oh, it's such a bad angle. Sorry, guys. I'll try and get I need a camera behind me, you know. That's what I'll do next time. So, yeah, on the left is the Bay 1073. It's basically, it's a Neve remake. It's a 1073. Oh, no, sorry. Is it a 1073? No. 1082? I can't remember. It's a Neve preamp with EQ. So it's got phantom power, phase switch, DI on the way in here. So I've got my guitar ready there if I need it, going straight into the preamp. And then it's got the gain knob on the top and then a high, mid, and low EQ and a filter. So, you know, that's just a go-to. This is actually what you're hearing me through now is the mic. The mic's going through that with a bit of a treble boost and a bit of bass taken out. And then next to it, in the middle, with the orange, that is a remake, or yeah, a 500 series, 1084, sorry, there you go, 1084 Neve. That that middle one with the orange is a, it's called the 1LA. So it's basically an LA-2A. You've probably seen that before on Waves plugins, the LA, oh, what's it called? I can't remember now. But yeah, it's an LA-2A. And I really like it, actually. I really like recording guitar through it, and I love vocals tracked with an LA-2A. I think that they are very... They add a lot of nice character, a lot of shine. The CLA-21, is that what it's called? Yeah. But, yeah, I like it because it's got a very interesting way the ratio works. I believe it's something along the lines of the harder you hit it, the higher the ratio goes up, because there's no ratio adjustment on it. It just has threshold and gain, and that's it. So it's a very simple compressor, really good for tracking vocals through. I'm actually hitting it quite hard at the moment because I realized when I step away from the mic, it definitely loses me a bit. So yeah, I could probably hit it even harder, to be honest. And then after that, the blue, this thing, that is the MAG or the MARG EQ4. So just more EQ on the way out before it hits Logic. The best thing about the MAG EQ, if anyone's used it, is the air band. So you've got like a sub frequency ducker at like 40 hertz. Then there's another one at 160. Then another one at 650. Then there's a high shelf. And then on the top, an air band, which you can select what frequency that boosts. So like a high shelf, basically. And yeah, the best thing about it, let me change back. The best thing about it is you can go all the way up to 40,000 kilohertz and boost from there. Now, the human ear obviously only hears around 20, 22, maybe 24,000 at the most. So to boost at 40 might seem counterproductive, but the slope that it does up to that gives you this beautiful brightness. I've only got it just slightly boosted at the moment because you don't need all the top end on my voice, but it is so sweet. If you've got a nice Neumann mic going through a Neve, a little compression through that MAG, by the time you get to Logic, you're in a good place. You know, you're in a good place. That's so that works for me. I've got a couple of empty slots there, which I'll probably fill eventually. I think I'd like to get an SSL G-Bus there. Although I've got one now, actually, on my little SSL mixer. Yeah, I haven't actually needed anything anymore. That's all I wanted from my little home studio mic on the way in setup. Airband, baby. Yeah, you know. Preamps are key when recording. Yes. Did someone ask, are preamps important? They are. I think they are. They are for microphones especially. And, you know, each preamp has a different characteristic, boosts different frequencies, adds different saturation. You know, you can go into the red with a preamp if you want to and get some nice distortion effects going on. So that can be fun. How long have we been streaming, guys? 36 minutes. Cool. Just keep chatting. This is fun. Are you using a MacBook to run Logic? Yes, I am. What synth did you use for the bass in the mechanism? I can't remember what synth, but I remember that we ran it through the PSP saturation plugin a lot. I think it might have just been 808 bass, just an 808 boom. And it was all saturation that gave it the wow, wow, wow kind of tone. Wow, 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 wow. Yeah, it was us messing with the saturation. Shout out to Friend with him. Yeah, that was good times. How do you feel about Nicholas Yar? Yeah, sick. Don't know him personally. cool music. You can make dogs whistle with that. Yeah, 40,000 hertz. I'm sure they'd be going crazy over that. What was it like working with Sam Smith? We need a 2020 disclosure Sam collab for sure. Well, I kind of want to save that question for another day because I'm sure we'll be able to get Sam on here at some point and maybe take Latch apart, Omen apart, other stuff that we've worked on with him over the years. So yeah, I don't know. We'll see. I'll save that story for another day. But Sam is one of my best mates. Love Sam. Yeah, there's not loads of people that I've become very good friends with post working with. You know, you become friends with them, but not people I would hang out with all the time. But Sam is definitely one of those people. Ed McFarlane's one of those people. Well, Jimmy Napes. Jimmy was actually just here. We were making tunes today, so I've been in here a lot today. Yeah, Jimmy Napes. Who else? Well, we went on tour for a long time with certain singers. Jessie Ware, she's a good friend. For the whole Caracal tour, we had Brendan Riley on the bus, so that was awesome. Brendan's awesome. Honey Dijon was on the tour bus with us for like 3 months. If anyone knows Honey Dijon, she is dope. Yeah, had some good times with Honey. Learned a lot about house music and DJing and partying. Shout out to Honey Dijon. She is a unique person. Man, I can't keep up with you guys today. Is this what it's going to be like? I'm not going to be able to answer everyone's questions at this rate. There must be, is there like a slow-mo mode or something? I thought I read that. UAD versus Waves, what do you think? Well, for me, my interface is the Apollo. I'm UAD everything. So, well, not everything. I do use some Waves plugins, so it depends what you want. I don't think there needs to be a versus. I think you use them all at the same time. UAD is expensive. Waves is not. So that's the key, isn't it? But there's definitely some Wave stuff that make a certain sound that sometimes I want to use. Like I will use the 1176 by Waves a lot. I like that on a vocal, just especially like if I'm at a session, I don't have my 500 stuff and maybe there's, you know, a problem with some of the gear at the studio, so we just want to go straight into the Apollo. I'll just I'll either use the UAD Tube Tech or I'll use the Waves 1173. Sorry, 1176. So yeah, H delay, I love Waves H delay. I use all the time, like every vocal ever probably that's on. But then I don't know, I like UAD. UAD I think are better at copying and remaking old gear, whereas Waves have got some of their own, you know, new plugins and they make their own synths and, you know, yeah, that it's more original stuff, whereas UAD are really focusing on recreating, you know, stuff like I was just talking about, the Neve and the LA stuff. So yeah, depends what you need it for. What do you use the SSL6 for? So going through the SSL6 is this synth in front of me here. I'm just going to take a sip of my wine, one sec. Oh yeah. Shout out Felipe Lopez 12 subscribing, thank you. What was I just talking about? Oh yeah, the SSL6. This thing right in front of me. Boom, this little mixer, 6-channel mixer. Channels 1 and 2, I've got the peak going through this synth in front of me. That's channels 1 and 2 at the moment. Channel 3, I think is empty at the moment, but it might be the 808. I think it's my 808, yeah. Yeah, it is. And then channels 5 and 6 is the Andromeda over there, that silver keyboard. So those all go through. And then there's a couple of external ins as well. One is the Moog up there. And the other... Oh, is that I've got a micro Korg over there on the shelves, but you can't even really see it. I don't even know if it's plugged in, actually. So yeah, lots of inputs on that mixer. I find it very useful. But the best thing about it, like I was saying last time, is it's got the G-Bus compressor on it. So by the time you've got the 808 going, the peak going, a couple other things, smash the G-Bus, and it just sounds like an already kind of good finished little demo. So it's good for jamming on. It's got some nice EQ. The channels 1 and 2 have got super clean preamps. Like, yeah, I think if I was recording someone with a super sensitive, very delicate voice, I would actually probably try and switch from my Neve and give that a go because it's very high quality and clean. The Neve's got more character, I would say, but sometimes you just want clean. I'm just going to turn on my AC. If I had to buy one piece of gear under $500 in this room, I would probably buy... I reckon you could get a Juno 106 for under $500. I might be wrong, but... Yeah, I mean, mine was free because it was my uncle's. But Juno 106. Or Juno 60. Any Juno. Have to have. For me. Favorite boutique thing is the SH01. Yeah. I'd say that. What is the story behind my song Tenderly? Oh, yeah. So Tenderly is way back in the day. I think it's on Spotify. Yeah, there's not really a story behind it. It's me on the vocals. So I'm singing, pitched up and messed with. So it doesn't sound like me, but it is. It's me and Howard when we were still living at home with our mum making tunes. I can't really remember much else than that. That and Flow, we just wrote in the really early days of Disclosure. There is not really much story behind it. We jammed it out. Do you typically sidechain vocal reverbs to the kick? Yes. I'll usually have a group of, like, a lead vocal or a stack of vocals going to a bus with plugins on, and the last plugin will be sidechain. I like to sidechain all the effects with the vocal, usually. How did you guys meet Fatoumata? So we've never actually hung out in real life, strangely, which is mad. But we did speak on the phone literally yesterday. We did an interview with her on Zoom. We've spoken over email a bit. But yeah, we had a proper nice, like, first real nice long chat yesterday. So that was good. But we found her through her music. Big fan of her music. Came across a few of her releases. Began messing with them, sampling them. We sent over a couple ideas to the label that we were thinking about releasing. Happened to be Ultimatum, and she was really happy and kind of impressed with the tune, I guess, and she definitely liked it, because the next day she emailed back and her team emailed back saying, would you like all the stems so you can get a better mix? So that's how the relationship started, us sampling her being like, I love it, send the stems back, finishing Ultimatum, and then now we have Marley as well, which I think we should probably get into in a minute. Let's do another 10 minutes of questions and then we'll break it down. Could you show us bus effects on your template? I'll show you it when we do Marley. Ultimatum. We can. It's probably a little different than it is now because it's about 3 years old, that song. 2 years old? 3 years old? But yeah, I'm going to show you guys a 2020 version of it. Like, I had to go through it today and just make sure all the plugins were working. And I was already making a slightly tweaked version of it for the live show that was supposed to be happening this year, which has just got a slightly different section at the end, so you guys will be the first to actually hear that. The dub version! Yeah, I'm so far behind. This is crazy. Do you like the movie Drive? Is that because last time you lot were saying I look like Ryan Gosling? Which I take as a huge compliment, by the way. I mean, that guy's a good-looking dude. So, thanks, everyone. I don't agree, but I'll let you guys keep saying that if you want. It's definitely doing a lot for my ego. What are the specs of your MacBook? I actually went through that last time, so you can check it out in the previous video. But it's the newest... best one minus the graphics card. Other than that, it's the best of everything you could get, basically. But you don't need a fancy MacBook to make good tunes, guys. I'd say that. My first album I made on when it was still white and plastic. I can't remember how much RAM or CPU it had, but it was definitely none, hardly any. And, you know, we made a whole album on that. So, yeah, just as long as you can press play and it doesn't stutter to a halt, you'll be all right. Do you need a sub to properly hear the low end? I mean, yeah, but speakers throw out sub. It just depends on your speakers, really. And like I said earlier, where you sit in the room, you'll find most speakers throw out a bit of bass, and if you stand in the corner of your room, you'll be able to feel it a lot more. So sometimes I'll get up and I'll go and stand over there if I really want to like pretend I'm in the club and how feel how it hits me. But I do have a sub in here as well. But yeah, most speakers, modern speakers, even little Adams or those Yamahas, like the new NS10 looking things, they throw out loads of bass. You just got to, it's more about the room treatment than anything. In my experience of moving to and from a lot of studios, there are good sounding studios and there are bad sounding studios, and they all usually have the same speakers in, a pair of NS10s and then a couple of bigger ones. Sometimes they sound good, sometimes they don't, and a lot of that's where you sit. How do you hook up all your outboard gear? Well, it's all going through my Apollo, some of it's going through the 6, but it's really complicated. Apart from the boutique stuff that's all USB through a USB hub, it's pretty much all going through the Apollo 8, I should say. Do you consider your music UK garage? Some of it. But I wouldn't say Latch is UK garage. But I wouldn't even say Latch is house, and yet people call it house. You know, it's in 6/8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I don't know any house that's in 6/8, so it depends. I've always found it very hard to categorize our music. I also just enjoy letting other people do it, because there's often some funny names that come up, like Love Step. Was one back in the day. I remember thinking, God, Love Step, really? Is that where we're at? Which USB hub? It's just a one off Amazon. It's 10 USBs, USB 3. The important thing is it's powered. Don't try and run all that stuff off your actual USB power. You need extra oomph. Did you see the video of the guy who thought Latch was in B flat? Yeah. I actually asked Howard yesterday, because I know you guys were asking this, what key Latch is in. And his answer was, oh, mate, I actually don't know. So I think it is a legit problem. I think that we need to ask Jacob Collier. That's what we need to do. Because I've asked a couple of pianists who I consider to be very dope, and they've both said different things. Howard doesn't know, and he wrote the chords. That guy was probably wrong with B flat or whatever you said. Jacob Collier will know. I will ask him and get back to you. But it is terrible. I can't answer that question. That just goes to show how much I am about twisting these knobs and pushing the buttons rather than the harmony. Are you in LA or the UK? I'm in the UK. This is my house in London. How do you punch in a MIDI on a track for hardware to voice, but still record in audio on a different track? So on Logic, if you're on your MIDI track, create a bus, send that signal to the bus, and then make a new audio track and select the input of that audio track as that bus. So whatever signal will be sent to that bus, which is muted, will come through on your new audio track. It's a return track. I think I explained that one. Might need to do that on Logic. I'll show you once we get into Ultimatum. Why is Latch so different from the other tracks on Settle? I don't know. Wasn't planned. I think Latch was probably the fourth song we wrote for Settle, so a lot of it came after Latch. DIY bass trap tips. Not really. I got nothing. Sit in a better place in the room. Do your parents ever listen or comment on your music? Yeah, all the time. My mum is probably watching this now. Shouts to mum. And yeah, she's actually quite involved in our social media and running the website. And yeah, she's great. It's kind of her job is disclosure admin. So, hey, mum. Jesus loves UK Garage. Yeah, shout out to Todd Edwards. I need that t-shirt. He said he'd give me it, but he hasn't given it to me. Need that t-shirt. What do you think about the interface UM2? I don't know. I used RME, the RME Fireface or whatever it was, some little RME, and then I went to Apollo. I don't think I've ever had anything else. I liked the RME, very clean signal, did the job, bit cheaper as well. Yeah. Thoughts on serum? I don't have any either. I'm afraid I never use it. Probably should get into that. But yeah, never used it. I haven't broken down Marley Marley yet for Vape Tura. Don't worry, you haven't missed it. The best analog synth ever? Come on, mate, that's difficult. Don't know. Too vast. I would say Juno 106 for me, but the debate could go on forever. Maybe a Mini Moog. Big up Admin Mum. What do you think of Flume? Love him. Me and Harley, we're good friends. Oh, and Howard. And Flume actually supported us on tour. Two times, maybe? Maybe three times. Did a couple of UK tours together and a Europe tour, so we're good mates. We've hung out outside of touring as well, and yeah, we have done a couple of sessions together, but nothing really came of it. I think we were just messing around too much and having fun and just, you know, enjoying each other's company. I think he lives in LA now, so yeah, he does live in LA now, so I've seen him more since he's been in LA because I've been there more too, so that's been nice. But yeah, he's a wicked dude. His last mixtape was banging. The tune he did with Slow Tie was so sick. Kenny in the house. Hey. How we doing, everyone? Welcome, welcome. Oh, thanks for that, bro. Jeez, yeah, we're popping off right in here. Okay, all right. Nice to see you all again. I'm sure some of you were probably there when I did the... what do you call it? Beat judging. Hope you guys all got your prizes. That was good fun. Yeah, I have to come back on and do that. Need to get you on as well, Kenny. Get you on this one at some point. All right, well, now all you guys are here, we should probably start breaking down a tune because we've been invaded. So let's do it. We're going to, for those just tuning in, we're going to break down Marley Marley. I keep saying that. My new song, Marley Marley, is coming out tomorrow. It features Fatoumata Diawara. She's a Malian artist. And she also sang on my previous song called Ultimatum. So we're going to break down Ultimatum today. Marley Marley's coming out tomorrow. And then on Thursday, we'll break down Marley Marley. So it's a whole week of Fatoumata Disclosure tunes. So yeah, let's get into it. Bang. Here we are. This is the session for Marley Marley. It was originally called Abate because... that's what I heard the lyric to be. Abate, umami, aho, abate. But yeah, we slowly learned about the lyrics. Well, she gave us the lyrics in English and we translated. And yeah, it was about making a decision about a partner, about marriage specifically. So we decided to name it Ultimatum because it's about a choice and a deep choice. So yeah, I like the name Ultimatum. Although it's not in English, that's kind of what it's about. But I know you guys aren't here for the lyrics or any of that stuff. So, yeah, we will get into Ultimatum. So, this section here, that is all drums. So, we've got battery doing quite a lot of stuff here, all in one window. I like to use the multiple outputs within battery. And, you know, I like to send different pads to... different places. This is the default, not the default, but the jack kit. So you've got some, like, you've got some kicks going on here, and I don't know what else is going on there, but yeah, the jack kit, it's a load of like Roland samples, 808s, 707s, you know the deal. Let me just turn off my AC. Boom. So there's that. We should probably just hear it actually to begin with. So I can't play all of it because we'll get taken down, but I'll just give you a little blast. So yeah, this is a lot faster. 124 BPM I've got it at now. That's because I was preparing it for the live show. That moment in the show, I didn't want to play it near the start. I wanted to play it near the end, and we're already rolling at that point. So I could easily turn it down back to, I think it's 118 BPM, the original. Let me see if that works. Yeah, there we go. All right, cool. So one thing to note about this, this is a good example of me using Ableton Rewire. All these tracks here, although they look empty, that is all coming in from here. Magic. So we got all the samples and the stems I was given from Fatoumata into Ableton because I really like the algorithms in Ableton, Pro and Beats and all that kind of thing. Very, very good. I would rate them higher than Logic. I know Logic just had a good update, but I still think Ableton is banging for warping audio. So yeah, let me walk you through that first. So as you can see, here's the tracks. The lead vocal is coming through these tracks here. So yeah, for those of you who don't know about Rewire, it's, you know, I'm basically using Ableton like a plugin or like a playback device. So audio is being played within Ableton, and then out here you select Rewire, and then you've got all of these different outputs that you can send it to. And then they appear in Logic in their designated slot. So as you can see here, the lead vocals going down 3 and 4. So the lead vocal is, I don't know where it is, but yeah, one of these. Oh, here we go, lead. It's all these, 3 and 4. So that's all you need to do to make Rewire happen. And yeah, I'm using it for this song because I prefer editing audio. Yeah, in Ableton for warping and for big speed changes. The original song is a lot slower. So yeah, that's why I chose Ableton. So we got those beautiful vocals coming through there. So as you can see, I've done a load of timing changes, editing. A lot of these parts weren't in this exact order originally in the song that she sent. So yeah, ton of editing. Kind of not worth going through now. What we got down here? These two are muted, so I clearly decided to not include those. Oh, here's the original song. Is that the original song? Yeah, it's called S Louis U C S Moi. That's what, marriage. That's how I remember it. It's called marriage. Yeah. Anyway, go check that out. So yeah, that's, if I solo the Ableton bus, that is basically everything coming in from Ableton. And it obviously changes that. So my favorite thing about this tune is the chords and the interaction of the chords and her vocal. And so what we decided to do after writing the chords, which are here, which we'll get into in a sec, is we sent her vocal through a Roland vocoder. I can't remember what it's called now, but it's the OG, like the old Roland vocoder, like the 70s one. Someone will post it, I'm sure. And it sounds banging. It's so noisy it just sounds lush. I'll see if I can play it for you guys. I'll play the vocal and the vocoder together, and then I'll solo the vocoder. Oh, it just makes me happy. Vocoder alone with a filter happening. I'm gonna be on the So there you go. That is the main vibe. And here's some of the plugins I've got. This is the bus for the vocoder here. So a bit of top-end boost there and a roll-off. And then the mag that I was talking about earlier. I've got 8 on the 10K setting there. So that's a hell of a lot of top-end. But I like all of that. And then this plug, which has been a revolution for me. It's the Gem Dopamine. It simulates something called the Dolby Trick, which I believe was invented by John Lennon. Well, that's so the story goes. It was invented for tape hiss reduction, I believe. But you can do a trick with it where... So what it does is it kind of... It's like it's a high-frequency booster and a de-esser all in one. So the compression knob is kind of a de-esser. And then the wet knob is, you know, how much of the effect you want in. And there's 2 modes, a couple different tape things. But I really like what it does. It's like, yeah, multi-band compressor / de-esser all in one. And it's wicked for bringing out those top ends. I'll give you a blast with and without. Yeah, so massive difference, night and day. It's not the best example because there's not much top end in that vocoder anyway. But I'll show you it on some vocals another time. And then we got some distorting H delay. Nice bit of ping pong. And then all going through the EMT 140. Nice big shiny plate reverb. Yeah, that's my go-to actual bus reverb as well, but I've got it on this track because it is being sidechained. So this is the just Logic. Basic Logic compressor. If I go to a different section of the vocoder, you'll see it's getting pumped as long as I solo my sidechains. So that's the vocal side of things. There's some cool ad-libby stuff that happens here. There's actually a guy as well in this tune. I don't know who it is. Here he is. Yeah, using a lot of EMT reverb in this tune. I think I made this probably before Valhalla. I even had it, or maybe even Valhalla was a thing. I don't know when that stuff came out, but Valhalla would be my go-to now, but I've kept it original. There's another vocal here which has been muted. Just dope. Yeah, so decided against that one, but we got those nice little ad-libs there, and then some beautiful soaring Fatoumata stuff here, I think.
Okay, encore.
Oh yeah, so that isn't even in the original tune. It's yeah, her saying okay, encore.
Okay, encore.
Yeah, that was actually, I just found that in the files and I was like, that is dope. That's going in my version. So loads of reverb-y delay stuff going on there. It's all Echo Boy. There's a lot of automation. Well, not a lot, actually. A bit of filtering and some feedback.
Okay. Encore.
Yeah, it's just reverb. Some filtering there. Yeah, so nothing out of the ordinary. Let me go back a bit, actually, and I'll show you guys what I've got on the vocals on the bus, because there's a hell of a lot on this. Yeah, wow, that's getting on for a crazy. So every vocal that comes in from Ableton is going through the 1176. Probably not too aggressive. No, quite aggressive actually. Yeah, I'm pumping those quite hard just to get some control. I think they were very uncompressed when I was getting them, so. Still can't find the Roland vocoder. Oh, damn it. I'll have to... They made a boutique version of it too. Search Roland boutique vocoder, and whatever that's based off is the one. Cool. So yeah, that's all the same. And Pro-Q 2 on all of those as well. Probably the same. Yeah, a bit more, a bit less rumble. Didn't even have the 3 at this point, so that's all just that. So yeah, all those vocals.
Are you mad?
Thanks for the subscription. All those vocals go through this bus here, which is a hell of a lot of stuff going on there. Straight into a distressor. So just taking off a little bit and gluing them all together, as you should, I think, on a bus. If you're using compression, you want to be kind of, you know, you want to try and, you're trying to bring everything together and make it all react in the same way. That's it, the VP330. Bang. Points to you, sir. Or madam, whoever you are. And then after that, more compression. I mean, yeah, that's barely hitting. So that's probably just because I love the sound of a tube tech. It adds a nice sparkle. And again, just a bit more glue. And then the gem dopamine is getting used to its full effect. This plugin, guys, I highly recommend it. It's in my top 10, I would say, and it's not very well known. There's a bunch of others. If you search like plugin Dolby Trick, I'm sure there's a few. I just found this one and it looks jokes and I like how it does that. That's fun. So yeah, this is what it's doing. Here's without. And I'll fade it in. So beautiful, top end, all the air comes to life, but at the same time, when she says Beyoncé or the S sound or whatever, any T, it compresses. So it's super useful for getting a nice, airy, clean sound quickly without doing loads of de-essing and EQ and compression. Boom, top tip for you there. Then we are de-essing anyway. Yeah, so it just hits on those two there, you can see. So just trying to control that top end and make everyone not have tinnitus when they're older. Multiband, a bit of... Wow, that's weird. I wouldn't do something like that now. Yeah, let's see what that is. Yeah, just controlling the lows and the high mids, I guess. Yeah, I wouldn't do that now, to be honest. I don't think it even needs it. Then into this bad boy, which I love, the Oxford Inflator. So I'll bypass it and put it back in. You guys can see what it's doing. So there's a little bit of a gain jump there, but what it's really doing is across three bands of signal boosting it. It's something like psychoacoustic, they call it, some psychoacoustic effect. It adds in frequencies and stereo-ness and all this beautiful stuff, and I don't know how it works, but you don't need to, because it's just one fader, which is what a plugin should be. All the hard work is done under the hood. You just push the button and off you go. Then we got this, which is just doing filtering. So that'll be full of automation. Yeah, so it's just, you know, doing the... Just slowly opening up to help build. And then a bit of Echo Boy. And a bit of reverb. So that's the vocals and all the processing. The bus is, yeah, a little bit of extra reverb there. Bus 3, if you ever see Bus 3 on my project, it is always chorus, always Logic chorus. So just adding a bit of stereo-ness to it there. I can play you on full and you'll hear what it's doing.
glunya mi alo, abede glunya mi alo, abede glunya mi alo, abede betaizi glunya mi asi, abede.
So that's just for the headphone crew, really, just putting a little bit of detune signal out the sides, just to give it some more width and richness. Let me just check the chat. Now we've done the vocals, see what you guys are saying. I don't really understand, but thanks for the tip. Good. Glad I'm doing a good job. Can you discuss de-essing? Yeah, so de-essing is the process of compressing just the S sound, or the high frequency sound of a vocal. So if I was to say to you, the C side, you would compress the S, but you don't want to compress the E-eyed. And that is because, you know, when you're making music and you want a vocal to sound really nice and crispy clean, you want to boost the highs so that the air of the voice comes through like that and it's all Mariah Carey vibes. But if you boost it too much, when you say the S sound or T sound, it hurts. Like, you're going to get a load of that signal through and it's going to be like painful, especially through a big live PA or in a club. You want that stuff to be squashed down. So you use a de-esser to get rid of the S sounds. Simple as that. Most DAWs come with a stock one, I think. Logic does, Ableton does. Yeah, I use the Fab Filter one now. I think it's the most transparent, because you don't want to DS too hard. If you start DSing too hard, you start to hear like a lispy sound, and it sounds all compressed and too ducky. Yeah, Mariah Carey vibes. Mariah Carey 100% was using this, but the real one. There is so much air on her voice, but when she says the T sound, it doesn't cut your head off with like a tss, ah. So I guarantee you there's some Dolby trick or something similar going on Mariah Carey. A lot of high frequency manipulation. And Britney, maybe. What else are you guys saying? Top tips. Thank you. Gem Dopamine. Never heard of it. That actual vocoder is 3,500 quid. Yeah, I'm not surprised. The OG Roland VP330. It is a lot. But like, it's a classic, and yeah, running a whole vocal through it is not usually something we would do. I would use the Logic one. Isotope do a really cool vocal synth one. That one's really dope. But that wasn't invented when I made this song. So we were just in a studio that happened to have that type of vocoder. So we did it. Oh, another cool thing I can show you guys is this track here. So this also was ran through the vocoder. And so this is just claps. So these are claps that were sent to, like, in the stems. I think this is just the claps. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. And then I can't remember where it is. I'm sure it will turn up somewhere through the project, but I sent those through the vocoder as well. And I think, actually, maybe they're embedded in this file. Yeah, they are. They're bounced into this. So you can hear there's rhythmic kind of chords being played from the vocoder, and that is through sending those claps to that actual vocoder synth. I wasn't sure if that was a thing or not when we did it, but we did it. Can you hear it? It's subtle, it's just going, and obviously instead of a clap sound, you're getting a chord. Yeah, so that's fun. Yeah, good tip for you guys. Send loads of weird stuff through vocoders. It's good fun. I was just doing it with Jimmy Napes today. We were sending like some of the drums through a vocoder. You know, that's always a fun thing to do. Send your drums to a vocoder, and as long as you're playing the chords at the same time, the drums will suddenly have all this harmony to them, and they'll have all these chords underneath. You're playing like a, you know, it'll go, which is really fun. And it thickens up the drums, and it can kind of bring the drums in to the song a bit more. You know, it gives the drums character and a bit of harmony. Okay, a bit of wine, and then we'll look at the drums themselves. Okay, so drums. Yeah, like I said, we've got... So there's... Oh, okay. So there's some claps here. Oh, yeah. So that is Fatoumata and her band, I'm guessing, clapping away. And then in Ableton, we've got claps here, which... Oh, yeah, so I've actually taken these from the original tune and then... These were the stems. So this is how the whole tune started, I think. I wanted to sample it for its drums. Yeah, that's right. Let me see if I can extend these. You can hear where it heads. It's pretty crazy. Jeez, can't play too much of that or I'll get in trouble, but come on, what a banger. So yeah, that's where the claps came from. Yeah, I bet you weren't expecting that. So that was the inspiration. I was listening through a load of old tunes like that, and that beautiful little thing happened. Chic claps. Yeah, I don't know. Must have just called them chic claps because I thought it sounded like a chic tune. So that's, yeah, that's the claps all together. So yeah, really percussive. We got some shakers here. Those will just be from Splice or maybe even Logic. I'm not too fussed about like recording own shakers and things like that. It's just a shaker. Yeah, a little tambourine there. And then this is, this I recorded at the studio, just with, I want to say like just an SM7 or a 58, just pointed at a snare drum. And I'm just doing clicks. So you can hear this. I just wanted to have a whole take where everything was a bit different. You know, I don't like too much looping going on. As you can see, like the tambourines and the shakers are already quite loop heavy. So I thought if I do an imperfect rim going over all that, you know, every 2 and 4 will be slightly different. Yeah, so just to add a bit of differentiation between all of that, add the claps back in. So that is the bulk of the percussion. And then if we move up to battery, we can see what battery is doing. I've forgotten. It's been a while. So this will be the kick down here. So it's a 3-layered kick, a click, a little crackle, and a big boom. We can see which is which. That's that. Tele kick. I don't know what that is. Yeah, that's just vinyl crackle. Oh, no, it's not. It is a kick, but you can see here I've taken out most of the frequencies. So it's just, yeah, it's just, it would be this. So yeah, it's just the crispy bit. And then the main kick. Oh, it's just an 808. Battery 808-2 going through the volume envelope, and I've given it some pitch envelope here too. I find this very useful in battery. You can add punch or subtract punch from your kick. So here's without. Let me just give it a bit more length so you can hear what it does. So that's a normal 808. And then with the pitch. Just hear all that, like 100 hertz. It's just giving it pop. I can exaggerate it a bit. So yeah, it just makes it into like a synth, you know, a synth kick almost. I'm actually messing with the frequency spectrum of the 808. Bit of high end taken off there, bit of compression. You've got all these effects within Battery. I love the transient master thing in Battery, just to add a bit of punch on the top. It's really good. We should probably do a whole day on Battery. It's my go-to for drums. Yeah, what else are we doing here? So that's the kicks all together. We should probably solo that. Probably is just track one. Very simple. 4-4 kick. How's the volume, by the way, of this, guys? Because I'm editing in small bits now. Is it all right? Like, if, can you hear that? Up or down? We're not clipping, I can see, but... Good, good, agreed, good. Okay, sweet. This thing... Ah, that's going to be an offbeat 808 hi-hat, no doubt. Let me put that there and then switch to this view. And then, yeah, here's all my Battery. So there's the 808 hi-hat. Got a bit of latency going on. Everything's flashing at the wrong time. But yeah, nothing too crazy there. That sounds like a Dilla clap to me.
Probably is.
Yeah, there it is. Dilla clap 3, Dilla clap 6. Yeah, Dilla clap 3, Dilla clap 6. How do you have separate channels for Battery? Okay, so this is really good. Oh, this is how I love to use Battery. So here's Battery here. When you have the plugin, Ableton or whatever, go to Battery, and then here is a list of what you do. So you can have it in mono, stereo, or you can have multi outputs. You can have 16 mono tracks, 25 mono tracks, 8 stereos, 8 monos. I've gone for 16 stereo tracks. And I'm not actually using all of them, I don't think. But I'm going up to 20 here. So 20 tracks or 10 stereo tracks. And yeah, what that allows you to do is then any sample in here that is, instead of just going down the master, what happens is you right click it and you see this menu here, output. You can just send it down the master, or if you go to direct out, here's your list of where everything's going. So this 707 clap, as you can see, it's going down 5 and 6, which is there. If I wanted to change it, I could change it to 3 and 4, and it moves to 3 and 4. So the reason I like to do that is because I'm quite a fan of having all of, like, at least one kit's MIDI in one window. You know, I know when I look at this just from habit that my kick is down here, claps and rims are here. Claps and rims are here. My hi-hats would be spread out here. And, oh, actually, this one's a bit of a mess. I would usually have hi-hats on top, claps and snares here. So as I just move up from the bottom to the top, bass to highs. Yeah. And I like it because you can do things like that, you know, a volume decrease by velocity all within one window. You know, I'm doing two sounds there at once with just the same simple. Instead of having to do automation, I sometimes like to do it in the MIDI. So that, you know, if I want to go and adjust a fader, I don't have to then go into the automation and do all that. Like, I do as little as possible volume automation in MIDI. I try and do it all in the MIDI. I do a lot of volume automation for vocals, but with MIDI I like to use velocity. Just keeps it simple. You know, if I want to turn up the rim, I can actually turn up the rim, and then then volume automation won't override, you know, what I'm trying to do. So that's why. Could you bounce stems from Battery if you wanted? Yeah, I mean, you would just do what I've done there, solo the specific tracks you want to bounce and press bounce. But I don't know if you do it within Battery. I'm not quite sure what you mean. Lol, turn up the rim. That's right. Logic looks pretty good to me. It is, guys. I'm doing it for Logic right now. What else we got here? I don't know. Well, anyway, that's what Battery's doing, and the kick. So put that all together. So that's all the drums going through this drum bus, which I will take apart for you guys now as well. So here it is on the, I'll put it on the mix window. Here's my drum bus. We've got a few plugins on there. I'll take them all off and you can do a little before and after. So big change there, lots going on. I will show you what's going on. Oh, I've got plugins on my master out as well. I'm just gonna turn those off. Okay, cool. So here is the drums of nothing. And we're first of all going into a Studer. Oh, I'd usually turn that off, but I didn't back then. I would also usually go compression first. I would go compression into saturation because I learned recently that saturation does a good job at, you know, squashing the transients, or at least just like clipping the transients with very little noticeable change in the sound, but still, you know, a decrease in the peak volume. So it's very good to come after a compressor into tape because it just keeps those transients down a bit from, you know, like a limiter would. It limits the transients coming out of a compressor. So to go tape into compressor is not really right, but well, there's no right or wrong, but I would switch those two around now. But anyway, we're going into the tape, which sounds like this. So just adding some, well, I'll turn it up loads so you can hear what it's doing. But when applied correctly and sparingly, it adds a lot of nice harmonic richness to the sound. You can see the chat is talking about Mac and Blue World a lot. I did make Blue World, for you person asking, yes, with Mac. And I will do a breakdown at some point, yes. I just want to speak to his team first and make sure it's okay. Yeah. Be respectful and all that. Rest in peace, Mac. Miss that dude. Anyway, then into compression. Oh yeah, I forgot to turn on the sidechain. So look at the difference here. See these two tracks up here. All right, here's without. And here's with. Hear all the shakers ducking up and down, and that's what that's doing. They're also doing a lot of the synths as well. I explained in the last video why you need a UAD and as normal sidechain one. It's to do with latency. I won't go into it again, but latency is the problem. So you need two separate sends. Moving on, after the compression, which was, looks like it's pumping quite heavily, but you can see I've only got the mix on like 40% here. So it's not too aggressive. So you can hear how it just brings up all of the underneath the kick. It's squashing the kick and making room for everything else to come back up in a really nice, like, tasty way. So full is clearly too much. You can hear it working too hard. So I decided 40% was about right. Then we're going into the Oxford Inflator, which is a bit more saturation and what I explained earlier, the psychoacoustic stuff. I'd usually push it a little harder than that nowadays, but I think back then I probably thought red was bad, so I stayed away from it. But red is good sometimes when it comes to saturation. And then I've got an EQ on there, but it's doing nothing, so I clearly was happy with the sound. And then we're limiting with the Oxford limiter. So adding a lot of gain on the way out, but it's really not reducing the peaks. Like you can see here, this is the reduction. It's barely touching. I'm not sponsored by UA, but they have been very nice to me since the last stream, and they are sending me a new interface. Shouts to Universal Audio. Woo! Yeah, so we're taking like 2 dB off there, hardly anything. Really fast attack, fast release. I like that compressor. It adds a bit of grit. You can hear it working a little bit, but I like it. It's a nice sound. Yeah, there's the drums, guys. We can hear the drums with the vocals. And what else have we gone through already? The vocoder. Here you go. Getting through it. We've got a few little build-up things here. What's that? Yeah, just little rises and falls. Yeah, noise going through some H delay, lots of feedback. What interface am I getting? The latest Apollo 8, I guess. Shouts to UA. Okay, moving on to the pads, of which the vocoder is part of. So we've done that. So yeah, the bulk of this song, the chords are my favorite VST poly synth that I talked about earlier. The Korg Legacy Poly 6. I really should have one of these in real life by now, to be honest. I use this plugin so much. I've rented one a few times when I've been to LA. I don't know why I don't just buy one. It's brilliant. It gives me a very immediate disclosure sound, which I think it'll make sense once we hear it a little bit. So yeah, let's look at the MIDI first. So these are Howard's chords, which he looks like he played them in because they're all a bit different. I don't know. They're quantized though. Wanted a very tight sound for this song. Quantized to 16ths. Do you mix in the same project? This is the final mix project, everything. I don't ever export stems and do a fresh mix. I kind of mix as we go and then go back and mix all in the same project. So yeah, everything you're hearing now is what you've got on your iPod or iPhone. There you go. That's the rising and falling beautiful Poly 6. The only thing being automated on the synth itself is the cutoff here. I was really happy with the sound after we messed with the attack and the decay a bit and the release. Yeah, there's no effects inside the synth going on. It's just a very simple sawtooth wave plucky sound. And yeah, all you can see the cutoff moving. Really simple, bit of resonance as well to give it some sparkle. You can really go in on this resonance. I like it a lot. Yeah, it's very like a Juno, very similar. Knobs instead of sliders, but I get a lot of the same feel and vibe off of it. What I really like about it is this stuff down here, the unison detune. So you can detune the voices within the synth, which you can't do on a Juno. You know, Juno has chorus on or off, which does a similar thing, but this is actually detuning the oscillators in the synth. So you can hear that's a mess if I turn it all the way down. So then unison spread pans them out. And then detunes them. So that's what I really like about that synth, is it's a different kind of chorus, flangey type thing. And, you know, instead of doing it with an effect, you're actually doing it with the synth itself. So that can be fun. And then look, also I do have some ensemble going on here, very, very lightly. Let's hear that if I turn this off. Okay, yeah, so that is detuning a bit and pushing stuff out to the sides. Yeah, so with just that, to me, that sounds like a Juno. But then with this extra stuff down here, then it's a different beast. So, what are you guys saying? You all good? Yeah, you're fine. I'm deep in the game now. So that's the Poly 6 and Howard's lovely chords. As you can see, it really doesn't do too much other than reverb build-ups, volume, H-delay, building and falling. Oh, I've got them all muted. So yeah, and here's the bus. So we got a bit of EQ, taking out some lows and the rumble, boosting 2K. That's going to be giving it a lot of bite. So just bringing out the resonance. Then we're going into that compressor again. So that's giving it lots of da, like at the start, down, 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 instead of vroom, 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 it's going down, 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 which I was looking for. Then a bit of decapitator, it's very subtle, just a bit of distortion. I can hear it just breaking up on the top a little bit. It just makes it sound like you've gone through a little preamp, makes it a little bit less digi. H delay, ping pong, and you've seen these a million times, guys. More reverb. And then, sending to a bit of reverb and a bit of chorus, as I always do. But then you got the side chain here, which will be being pumped off of the kick. All right, doesn't actually sound there. So yeah, that's what that's doing. That is the chords and that's what. So those are the same chords we were sending to the vocoder as well. So Howard was playing the vocoder as I was sending the vocals and the claps, and so that's what it's doing. Yeah, he killed those chords. Moving down, we got an O behind synth here. That was also in the studio on that day. We did this at Sleeper Sounds studio in London. It's in Notting Hill, West London. It's owned by a dude called Guy, which I love. Guy Chambers is his name. He produced a lot of Robbie Williams stuff back in the day. And he was in a band too. Name escapes me now, but yeah. His studio is amazing. It's got an EMI desk in it from Abbey Road. Every classic synth you've ever seen. It's a banger studio. So that's where the vocoder was, and also this Oberheim. That's going through some ring shifter, Logic ring shifter. I can show you how crazy that thing is. Mental, mate. So yeah, very subtly using that just to give it some movement and a bit of EQ. Oh, and it's being sent to the Juno chorus as well. So yeah, all those together make up the pad build-up type synth. Dropping it on the two. Classic disclosure move. And wait, bang. Cool. All right, now my favourite bit. I'm looking forward to this. A real Wurlitzer being played by a real Howard Lawrence. So, yeah, bit of editing done here and chopped up, but I'll give Howard some credit here. He did play a lot of this in one go. This is one take, just slightly nudged timing-wise, but you'll understand why when you hear it. I mean, I don't know how he played this. This was at this speed, too. I don't think we sped it up. Did we speed it up? No, because the original speed of the tune is 118. So, yeah, you can see it goes blank there, which means it's only been sped up for you guys here. So, yeah, let's listen to that. Come on. That shot, oh, that gives me goosebumps. Love that one, man. When Howard nailed those chords, I was very happy with him that day. I was like, mate, you're having a good day. Yeah, what we got on here is big change. Let me take everything off. Howard bot is confirmed. Howard is confirmed bot. All right, so we're taking some rumble out. Then we're giving it quite a lot of logic overdrive. Let me loop this. Just giving it some gain, really, not changing the sound too much. I was obsessed with this compressor then. I would never use this compressor now on that. But yeah, you can see it's just controlling. It's bringing out the underneath the jams. Who recorded the Rhodes? It's actually a Wurlitzer. It's not a Rhodes. There is Rhodes coming up later, but it's a Whirly. And I recorded it. I think we went through a Neve, through that lovely EMI desk that he has there from Abbey Road, like the Abbey Road, and straight into the project. This is it here. Using Transient Master there just to bring down a little bit of the noise and the pss in between the stabs. Controlling the low mids there with the multiband compressor. Probably wouldn't have used that now, to be honest. I quite like all those lows. This will be a filter that's being automated, so I'll just leave that. And then a bit of H delay. Then just a bit of tremolo and sidechain. That's it. That's the Whirly, and I love it. Getting through it now, guys. There's a lot in this tune. We've done vocals, we've done synths, we've done the Whirly. Now we're on to the Rhodes. I think this just backs up the Whirly. It's not that different. There was a Rhodes in the studio. He had a Wurlitzer and a Rhodes, so just felt nice to layer up that Whirly with something a little bit more twinkly. Lovely. That is all the pads. What we got left? Bass. Two basses in this. Mostly Monarch. Shock horror, guys. I know. It's my go-to. Let's go to the first drop, if that's what you call it. Yeah, so it's in the build up, I think. Is that a build up? Yeah. classic Moog sound there, even though it's a Moog copy, obviously. Here's the MIDI, for those wondering, doing octaves most of the way through. Very 303-y. Yeah, it is very 303-like. Yeah, if you set the Moog up in a certain way, you can get it sounding pretty close to a 303. The filter doesn't do the same kind of vibe. You know, it's a Moog filter, but we're not doing... the filter and the resonance, but we're not doing any resonance in this, really, except for the build-up. Yeah, I mean, sawtooth wave sounding glorious. But then underneath it, we do have a real Moog. So while... that was being, I think Howard was messing with the automation, doing some stuff with this, doing the build up. I was sending that MIDI out to a real Moog, which was, we were doing a lot of resonance and crazy stuff with. So let's hear that. So yeah, you can hear I'm like detuning it, I'm doing the resonance, I'm doing some cutoff stuff, I'm just messing with it whilst it plays itself. And I think I probably did heaps of those. Just did, yeah, there's loads there. Oh, there you go. Yeah, I definitely wanted it to sound like a 303 because I've even put a 303 in the picture of the Monarch. So yeah, when you put those both together, I think that the digginess of the Monarch, even though I still think it sounds banging, combined with that nice real Moog over the top, gives you the kind of best of both worlds. Analog meets digi, doing its thing. Do I add a sub under the bass? Sometimes, but in this case, no. But I have got a bass boost going on there. So I'm boosting 50 hertz and I'm taking out 30, and this moves with the automation, I think. Yeah, and I'm boosting here as well, just to give it some bite. But no, I didn't need a sub for that. It was throwing out loads of sub already. Didn't need anything. I'm going into a DBX 160 compressor there. A very fast, a very attacky compressor. Give you a little before and after. Here's before. Here's after. So it just gives you that nice at the start of each note. Very like aggressive, but I like what it does. Then into some overdrive, Logic overdrive, and a bit of Valhalla. Hey, Valhalla was a thing. Damn, surprised I didn't use it more. So yeah, Valhalla on the bass. Not opposed to putting reverb on the bass. You can see I've taken out all the lows of it anyway. It's just doing some splashy. It's just doing some splashy automated over the top. Yeah. How do you think about compression? When do you use it? I use it when I want to control the volume of a sound. Simple as that. Not sidechain compression. That's more of an effect for pumping. But if you want to reduce the dynamic range of a sound so it isn't very loud and then very quiet, you can make it all very loud and very quiet. That's what it's for. More, it's for control. Simple as that. There you go. So let's... So now I can get onto this. Now I've shown you the bass. Here's like... this little edit I was making for the live show. So this is after the last chorus. We go to this sneaky section here, which was, man, I was looking forward to playing this. It was going to catch everyone by surprise, but it can catch you guys by surprise instead. Thank you. rolls out for like another 2 minutes instead of just ending. So yeah, and we were going to turn all the lights off for that bit. It was going to be like, oh yeah, everyone thinks the tune's coming to an end, and then fucking lockdown. So yeah, there is most of it, guys. I guess it's just the mix bus is all that's left. And it's pretty similar to last time. I mean, I'll explain it because I feel like there's a lot more of you here now, and I'm gaining followers like a lot, which is awesome. So I'll go through it again, but my mix bus, it doesn't really change from song to song. I have a pretty go-to procedure, which I've used pretty much since Ultimatum. So we're going straight into the SSL G-Bus. Just taking off like 2-3 dB, really not much at all. I'm filtering out the bass, so the bass isn't triggering the compressor too much. If it was, it would look something like this. So a bit too aggressive. So I've taken off the lows, and you'll see it's less. Yeah, I think that's how you're supposed to use that compressor. You just kind of tickle it a little bit. But I love the G-Bus. It just glues it all together nicely. Then into the Studer on the GP9 set. Yeah, I mean, I would love to have a real Studer. I probably would run it through some real tape, but I can't afford one of those. And they're massive. I mean, where would I even... That is not going to fit in here. Then onto this little beauty, which we talked about earlier, the Drama SS3. I can't speak anymore. S3. S7-3. Yeah, we'll just pretend that didn't happen. This is a multi-band compressor, and it has one knob, which is why I like it. I can just hear it working. I don't need to mess with it. So here it is without. Sorry, we're peaking here. With. So that's too much. So that was nothing. That's full. So I usually ride it around. I think it was there, was it? Yeah. About like 60%. I basically just fade it in until I can just start to hear it working. And I know it's controlling the whole range of the spectrum. It's got a nice air band on it too, which I never use. That boosts the highs, kind of like the mag. But yeah, I just use it as a kind of safety band, to be honest. It's just if anything pops out the mix, like a random 2 BVs at once cut through, or a guitar goes crazy, or a synth pops through, it'll just squash that frequency nicely. Then we go into Saturn, which is saturation again. I mean, yeah, you're only going to really notice that on very good speakers or headphones. Very, very minor. And then the inflator. So that's without. And with. God, I love that thing. It's so good. And then we are going into soothe, but I took it off because it uses so much CPU. But we can just look at it quickly. So we're taking out all of this crap here. Just all of those nasty bits. So that when you press that button there, you hear what it's removing. So when I take it off, all of this stuff is gone. Any harmonics, hi-hat, resonances you don't like, it's just a quick fix on the master out. Sometimes I leave it on, sometimes I don't, but I always have it on during a session nowadays just to save myself from tinnitus, because those frequencies all around there are what I think give me tinnitus. So I turn it right down and make sure it's controlling that area. What does the inflator do? There's a video. I think that the video would do a better job at explaining it because it's difficult to explain. But it's a frequency enhancer. It lifts everything up and gives it life. Psychoacoustic effect is the word. Don't quote me, but I'm pretty sure that's what it is. It's a plugin, yeah. Do you have the inflator running on most channels? No, most buses, yeah, because I like it as glue as well. It glues stuff together. Like, you know, if you've got all the BVs, I would put through an inflator because it gives them all character interacting with each other. And same with drums. I've got one on the drums there. Yeah. But not on every channel. You can. That would probably sound awesome, but no. Where were we? Oh, yeah. EQ, none. I was clearly happy with the mix. I may have had some on and then probably took it to mastering, showed Stuart, my mastering guy, what EQ I'd had here, and then we probably did it on some outboard gear, and then I deleted it. But I seem to remember just being happy generally with this and not needing any boosts. Yeah, if I was to re-EQ it now off of my pretty tired ears, I would probably look at, well, not boosting those, but maybe taking a bit of bass out and a bit of highs and boosting something like that, maybe, but I don't know. I've been in the studio all day. I was with Jimmy earlier, and now going through all this, I can't really hear anymore, so I wouldn't bother EQing at this stage. And then I've got the Pro L here as a guide, but it didn't end up going through this. We took it mastering. And yeah, Stuart Hawks at Metropolis is my guy. Well done, chat. You nailed it. Do you have a limiter on the master? Yeah, that's what that's doing. But always, when you bounce out your tunes, if you're sending them off for mastering or getting them mastered, send them off with no limiter. I can't tell you how many people, Stuart told me that he gets masters sent to him now, where they're already just smashed into zero, and he's like, well, there's not, what can I do? There's no headroom to play with. So always send your pre-masters off with tons of headroom left for the mastering engineer to play with, because if you send him a file where it's all crushed to zero, he's immediately just gonna have to turn it down anyway to make any kind of adjustments. Let the mastering guy do the limiting. You do EQ, you do compression, do all that stuff that I just did if you want, or more, stereo enhancing, any of that. But whatever you do, don't limit the track before you send it to the mastering engineer, right? It's literally their only, not their only job, but it's like one of the main parts of their jobs. And they can hear stuff that you and I just can't. Like, I've been sitting there with Stuart before, and he'll go through three different limiters with different attack settings on each, and they all sound exactly the same to me. And he's like, you can't hear the difference of this and this and this. And that's really doing stuff to top end guy, can't you hear it? I'm like, mate, we're talking like 1-2% here. So let them do that. They can do all the dithering stuff, all that. Are your tracks at -6 when you send them? Maybe more. I would do like -8 to -10. It doesn't matter. Like, as long as the recording's clean, and you know, it's a 24-bit WAV or AIFF, whatever you want to send, as long as it's clean recording, you know, at that point, it's just digital information. You could send them a -15. The first thing that they'll do is normalize it anyway and then limit it. So, you know, don't send them like a -30, but yeah, anywhere from like -6 to -10, you're going to be fine. And you'll get a better master from it. You will. Don't be doing that. Do I use 44.1 or 48? I still use 44.1, mostly for CPU sakes, save CPU. But yeah, I've thought about this a lot. Like, I thought about changing to 96 for a bit. I even thought about seeing what the hell would happen if I changed to like 192. Let me change my screen. But yeah, I decided for dance music, where there's this much top end going on anyway, you know, tss, 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 you know, all you're gaining from a higher sample rate is more top end frequency range. So, you know, if I was recording an orchestra, I would love to do that at 192 or 96, because you're getting that extra bit of sparkle on the violins. But when you're doing this much hi-hats and shakers, and, you know, it's really loud and like crispy, I personally like what 44.1 does to my sound. It just, you know, everything gets bounced down to 44.1 anyway. 16-bit WAV, 44.1 is like what you'll get given to send to the radio and send to CDs and all of that, to Spotify, Apple. So, you know, if you're already at that frequency, that's how it's going to sound. I understand the vibe of beginning at a higher sample rate, converting down to 44.1. I'm sure you can achieve some good results, but with this type of music, I really don't see the need. There's plenty of top end going on up there. If anything, I'm taking out top end more often than I'm adding. So, yeah. When you mix, are you keeping the peaks around minus 10, or do you not worry where the peaks are? Yeah, on the master fader. So I always try and leave the master fader at zero. This one I've been riding for you guys, but yeah, I always leave these at zero and make sure that I'm peaking at around minus 10, minus 8. What with the plugins on? Let's see where we're at. Yeah, so for me, this is coming in a bit hot. So I would gain it down here, perhaps. I mean, it's an old project, so I'm still learning at this point, but yeah, I'd back it down. But we're safely in the green, you know, it's fine. Oh, shite, sorry. Screen. here it is, the... Oh, I don't know how I can show you guys without it. Oh, yeah, here we go. If I... here's the mixer. Yeah, here's my master here. So we're peaking at minus 5. The average is probably minus 8, minus 10, something like that. So, you know, it's a little hot for my liking, but it's in the green, so that's fine. Yeah, I would usually... for me, a good starting point is, like, if you make sure your drums are coming out at between minus 6, minus 8, which I think these are minus 6. Yeah, I mean, that explains why we're coming in a bit hot at the end. So nowadays, I would make sure my drums are, after being limited a bit, coming out at minus 8. And then I found, once I've built everything else around that, the bass is in the right place, the pads, the vocals, by the time I get to the end, I'm usually in a good space, gain-wise. So, yeah, get your drums, you know, lightly limiting and peaking at a reasonable minus 8 dB, and you won't need to worry about any distortion at the end, unless you're mixing crazy stuff. I don't know, but for house music like this, that's my take on a bit of gain structuring for you. Okay guys, I'm gonna have a quick toilet break, get some more wine, and then I don't know if I'm gonna make a tune today. I'm a bit dead. I was already making tunes like all day. So how long we've been going now? Yeah, 2 hours of a breakdown. It's been pretty in depth, but yeah, get some questions ready for when I get back. If I've missed anything, I'll go through it. We could look at Ableton a bit more, some other stuff in here, Rewire going on. But yeah, that's Ultimatum. I will be right back. Yeah, see you soon.
Are you mad?
All right. We back in the room. Put that back there. How are we doing, gang? I've switched to the white. I don't usually like to switch like that, but here we are. I'm an expert on wine, as you know, so let me just... Oh yeah, that's definitely white wine. Yeah. It's not red. It's not rosé. It's definitely white. Yeah. Yeah. 100%. Also, I don't know if you guys can see, but someone last time I know spotted this coaster. And yes, it is a Slytherin coaster. Blurry. There you go. Now that is a long story, but over here, look. Can you guess whose coaster this is? That's right. I'm a Slytherin, according to the Harry Potter J.K. Rowling approved website, pottermore.com. I did the test and I'm a Slytherin, which I'm really happy about. And Howard is actually a Ravenclaw, but for some reason he has a Gryffindor placemat. So that's the vibe in the studio, you know, good versus evil. evil mean beats, happy nice harmony. I guess. So yeah, just thought I'd let you know about that. I do like being a Slytherin though. I would definitely say that that is the best house. What do you guys think about that? I mean, Snape is clearly the best character. You hate him the whole way through, and then right at the end he comes good and he's like just this amazing hero and made all the sacrifices. But then Draco Malfoy is an asshole and really annoying, so you know, Ryan Malfoy Gosling. I bet you Ryan Gosling's a Slytherin. Guarantee it. But yeah, Howard's a Ravenclaw and he's pleased about that, because I guess some of you guys know Howard's really into like farming and growing food and permaculture and all this kind of thing. And I think Ravenclaw, they're into that. They're into the kind of nature, the nature side of things. But then I am too. And I don't really like snakes, but hey, here we are. Slytherins are chill. That's right. Anyway,
are you mad?
Did I? Oh, thanks to all the gifting as well. Gifters, subscribers, you guys are awesome. Anyone who's donated as well through the link to Great Ormond Street, you're a legend. Yeah. Thank you, guys. This is great. Is there anything I missed that you want me to go back on in the project? If not, I think I will make a beat. You guys are keeping me going here. There's a lot of you in the room. 816. Wow, awesome. So yeah, I think I'll make a quick beat. I downloaded a load of break beats earlier off of Splice. Just like so I kind of fancy making something quick and not too technical with a few loops and just like break beaty stuff. So yeah. How did I get noticed by my label? We did, so we're signed to Island Records in the UK and Capitol in the US, and we got noticed by Island Records, well, a subsidiary of Island Records called PMR, who also represent Jesse Ware, SG Lewis, a bunch of cool people. And we did that remix for Jesse Ware of Running, and that got us noticed by the label. They were like, this is awesome. What's your guys' plans? So the remix for Jesse led to us getting signed. I think we also had written Latch at that point, so we played them Latch and they were like, oh yeah, let's do this. Which was cool. If it's not too much to ask, could you go over how you warp in Ableton? I mean, for this project, it's just like a bit of tidying up, as you can see. I've got all the vocals in pro mode. If I'm warping vocals, I'll always do pro mode. If I'm doing claps and stuff, I will always do beat mode most of the time. If I want to preserve those transients, beat mode is the best. But yeah, I mean, I'm just tidying stuff up here from the sample, getting the claps in time. Like I said, I don't really use Ableton too extensively. It's mostly just for audio playback because I like the algorithms. But yeah, it's nothing too extreme. Are you not signed to Virgin EMI? No, I'm definitely not. I would know that. I'd be worried if I was, because I'd be like, what just happened? But it is definitely Virgin. Island. I kind of like the VIP more. Oh yeah, I made a VIP of the Running remix for Boiler Room when we did Back to Back with Scream. I pretty much made it on the way there. I just took the project, changed a few things around. We should go through those one day and compare them both.
Are you mad?
Will you guys make your own label? Yeah, we have our own label. It's called Method Records, which we run with our managers. Yeah, breakdown of Jesse, that'll come. Bicep and Disclosure collab, I would love to. I love those guys, man. Really, really sound guys. 100%. I think they're big into their analog gear as well, so I'm sure they could teach me a thing or two about 909s and synths and whatever. Yeah, that would be a lot of fun. I really, really like those guys. What speakers did you use before the Neumanns? Oh my God, I haven't told you this yet. All right, so yeah, for the first two albums, well no, first album and then a bit of the second, but definitely all of Settle. We made that above my dad's work, where he works. He runs an auction house. So he's an auctioneer. He sells antiques, like furniture and stuff. And let me change the screen. Yeah, there's a little flat apartment in the roof of the building. It's horrible. There's no running water. There's no heating. It's a mess. But thank you very much. But it was a space for us to use, and we had no money or anything, so we were more than happy to take it. And the speakers that I could afford at the time were zero. I got everything for free. Like, I just asked people all around. So my uncle, who we found the Juno in his attic. He also had a pair of little Tannoy monitors. I can't remember the brand now. They were little blue things with a silver speaker, Tannoy. I really liked them. They were nothing fancy, but they were pretty flat, pretty true sounding. I also grew up with Tannoys in my house. My dad had a pair of Tannoys in the lounge for listening to music on, so I was quite familiar just with the Tannoy kind of sound. So I don't know if that helped or not, but I liked them. But then the best bit is the bigger speakers we had for like checking the bass and things were a huge pair of Sirwin Vegas, and they were red and black, and we got them in the auction downstairs for £40 with an amp and a digital radio, like a little stand-up digital radio. Terrible. Really bad sound, really hi-fi, loads of bass, loads of treble, not true to the sound at all. So very like difficult to mix on, but if you were writing through them, you'd get a big vibe going straight away because it sounded like you were in a club. You know, I wouldn't advise mixing on them. I mixed on the Tannoys mostly, and in my car. I used to take my whole laptop out to the car. It's before I had it, like, really any outboard gear. Take my laptop into the car, plug an auxiliary cable into it through the speakers. I had a fucking huge sub in the boot, a big orange thing from Halfords, and I would just sit in the car at full volume, checking the bass of White Noise, listening to Latch, listening to all of the album, and just switching between my favorite songs at the time and my song, and I just matched them up. Probably took me three months or so to get it perfectly happy. Now I think I could have done it a lot faster, but you know, I was learning and I still wanted it to sound professional, which I think it does. So yeah, it was all Logic plugins, a few Waves plugins, and huge Sirwin Vegas in my studio, and then my little Volkswagen Polo, 1 liter Polo from 2001. So yeah, I don't know how we did it, but that was good times. Shouts to Will Neff. If Will Neff is in the chat, thank you, Will. I want to give a shout out to Will, actually. He helped me understand Twitch a lot better and to get to know the ins and outs. Once I bought all my cameras, he really helped me with the admin side of stuff and getting it all working and getting the stream smooth and what everything is. You know, it's a bit of a different world here. So, yeah, shouts to Will Neff. Thank you, Will. What are your thoughts on Rudimental? I love those guys. I've had some really good parties with them. We used to run a festival down in Brighton called Wildlife Festival, and we'd headline one day and they would headline the other day. So Wildlife was like our kind of night, I guess. We would do Wildlife nights all over the world, and then we decided to do the festival with Rudimental on the other day. And yeah, we did it three years in a row. It was a lot of fun, a lot of hard work. But yeah, I love those guys, man. I mean, musically we're very different. You know, they're kind of more into the drum and bassy jungle side of things. And then they do dip into house. I love, love, love their song Spoons. Spoons off their first record, I love. That's such a beautiful house tune with M&EK singing, I believe. But yeah. Love those dudes, man. We all live very near each other as well. We're all around East London, North London, so I've seen them all driving around in their Mercedes G-Wagons now and again. Some of them have got G-Wagons. So yeah, no, they're all the best to those boys. All right, I'll do a couple more questions and then let's make a little beat. Spoons is sick. Yes it is. How would you compare compressor characteristics? Aggressiveness, how hard they squash, what kind of harmonics they give off during the compression process. It's hard to explain, but each compressor has a different kind of EQ sound to it. Some are bright, some are dark, some are distorted. They all react in different ways, and that's because, you know, a real compressor is made of mechanical parts and they all do different stuff. So yeah. Kechenada collab would be ridiculous. Yeah, love Kechenada, man. Good dude. We've done some good shows together. Done a lot of shows together, actually. He supported us a few times. Huge. Huge sound. Love him. Love his productions. Epic guy. Really nice guy as well. Him and Pomo. Yeah. I love their sound. I love the swing they get on everything. It's very cool. Very Dilla, like, influenced. Really dope. And, yeah, he did a wicked remix of January back in the day, too. That's what led to us touring together and, yeah, becoming friends. Are you practicing any instruments right now? Nope. Sadly not. I should do. Would you make a collab with SG Lewis or Tom Misch? I've worked with both of those guys. Tom only once, and not much came of it. It was just a fun day. Super nice guy. But SG's been in here a few times. We got a few tunes together. Mostly really clubby stuff, because we usually end up just getting drunk and hanging out halfway through the day. But yeah, we'll keep working with SG. I really like, because when he comes in the room, he kind of does a lot of the stuff that Howard does for me. You know, he'll lay down the chords, and he's got really good vocal ideas, and he can sing. So yeah, I kind of do my normal role, and he brings in some different ideas, which is really fun. Yeah, good dude. Where did you produce for your upcoming album? Mostly we wrote it in LA, mixed it all in here. Make a beat. Yeah, agreed. Let me clear this. Actually, let me put you on the screen for a sec, just so you don't see all my projects. Favorite headphones, not for mixing, but for listening to, I love the Neura headphones. I've got them on the floor here, actually. I'll show you them. So they're pretty weird. They're like, as you can see, in ear and around the ear at the same time. So there's a little thing in there that pokes into your ear hole, and then the outside of it does the bass. They sound so good. Pretty hi-fi. I wouldn't mix through them really, but I like them. And they're wireless and noise cancelling and all that. And I think they do a really good deal at the moment. I think you can get them on finance for like an insanely cheap price a month. So you just pay per month to keep them and use them, which is really cool. Yeah, I don't know the price, but check that out. How do you spell them? Oh, it's N-U-R-A. Neura. Yeah, Artwork showed me them. Shouts to Artwork. He was going on about them when we were in Bali having dinner. Okay, I'm just loading my template, guys. Won't be a minute. Can you show Ableton Live project for live sets? Yeah, I mean, they're a bit of a mess. Oh, you mean the actual thing we used to use in the show? Sorry, I thought you meant like all the prep. Yeah, I mean, it's on a different laptop, different setup. But yeah, I could probably pull that out eventually. That's a good idea. I'll try and find that. There's a video on YouTube you guys should check out. We did a rundown of our live setup with Red Bull once. If you search Disclosure Red Bull Live Setup, it's pretty thorough go through of all of our gear. Okay, I'm gonna make some tunes. Probably not for that long, but yeah. So I got a load of breaks from Splice.